proposed worship is in the bulletin of you, the responder has indicated. The spirit of life. Spirit of power.
Stir our hearts afresh.
Spirit of love.
Bless us and do us our neighbor.
Spirit of creativity.
Enable and empower the gifts you have given.
Spirit of eternity.
Draw us and lead our into your kingdom.
And we pray, the Spirit of God blow into our lives, move us to action, break down the walls that separate us, where our language divides, offer us translation. Where our fear overcomes, fill us with the fire of courage. Where our lives are becalmed, fill our sails with wind, moving us forward into the unknown future. Fill us with the hope and promise of Pentecost. Amen. And the responsive song is 104, part 2, it's 827 in the hymn book, 827.
Thank you.
little bit cold, but it's a good day. Glad to be here, glad to be here together. Now today is called Pentecost, so it's a very special day. And some people have read on just to recognize that it's Pentecost, and that's the Pentecost. It means 50 actually, Penta and 50, but it's a special day to celebrate when the Holy Spirit came to the people in the church. And so there were different languages, and when we have our scripture lesson later, we'll be hearing about how people spoke in different languages to each other. And you know how that can be quite confusing when somebody speaks French or Spanish to us, and we don't really know it that well, do we? We have lots of good English, but being able to listen to other languages is hard, but that's the way we get to understand other people. So it's similar in the Bible, because the Bible was written a long time ago, and so we have different ways in which things are said. So if we read in different Bibles, we read things differently. They're said differently, even though they mean the same thing. So something like, "The Lord is my shepherd." We know that psalm really well, "The Lord is my shepherd." So in the American Standard Version that's been put forward, though, it says, "Jehovah is my shepherd, I shall not want." And then in the Bible in Basic English, it says, "The Lord takes care of me as his sheep. I will not be without any good thing." And that seems quite different than what we've been used to hearing. But it is all in English. And in the Common English Bible, it says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I lack nothing." And in the Jewish Bible, "Adonai is my shepherd, I lack nothing," because Adonai is a name for God. And then in a standard Bible, it says, "The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing that I lack." And in basic English, "The Lord takes care of me as his sheep, I will not be without any good thing." So it's similar to another translation that we have. And another common one, "The Lord is my shepherd, I lack nothing." And so we have all of these different words that say the same thing. And so we recognize that within our different languages as well, that we can say different things, but we know that they mean the same thing. So we're glad for Pentecost and the celebration, for wearing red, and for being able to talk about God's Spirit helping us to understand each other. And that's what Pentecost is all about. So let's join together in prayer, and if you bow your heads and close your eyes, and we'll all join together. O gracious God,
O gracious God,
I thank you for being able to understand
so many different people.
Amen.
They were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and began to talk in other tongues, and as the Spirit enabled them to speak. There were Jews living in Jerusalem, religious men who had come from every country in the world. I don't see Canada, so we won't go there. When they heard the noise, a large crowd gathered. They were all excited because each one of them heard the believers talking in their own language. In amazement and wonder, they exclaimed, "These people who are talking like they are Gentiles, how is that? Then all of us hear them speaking in our own languages." And here's where we go on some names. We are from Parthia, Media, Elam, and Mesopotamia, Judea, Cappadocia, and Pontus in Asia, with Pirin and Pamphylia from Egypt, and the regions of Libya near Cyrene. Some of us are from Rome, both Jews and Gentiles converted to Judaism. And some of us are from Crete and Arabia. Yet all of us hear them speaking in our own languages about the great things that God has done. Amazed and confused, they kept asking to each other, "What does this mean?" But others made fun of the believers, saying, "These people are drunk." And then we have a message from Peter, which he gave after this. Then Peter stood up with the other 11 apostles and in a loud voice began to read to the crowd, "Fellow Jews, and all of you who live in Jerusalem,
some of the special days and things that were done. And of course, we seem to always remember the sports and the big football games and being out there on the field and listening to the cheerleaders. They would leave the school in spirit and lead to try to succeed. It was for bonding the students together and for a good level of loyalty to the school. It's been so long for me, I had to look up the old cheer for our school. West, we'll go down in history. Hill, West Hill High is fighting well. One hope, say, show. Come on, West Hill, knock them out. Yay, West Hill. Nice one for the choir. And you may remember some schools would have 2 bits, 4 bits, 6 bits, $1. All for our school, stand up and holler. And maybe at some church camps as well, you heard some competition going on between the different cabins when they would have their cheer. We've got spirit, yes we do. We've got spirit, how about you? And then yay. And the whole goal was that each side would get louder and louder as time went on. Not a lot of cheering in the church today. And maybe that's because we haven't gotten enough of the message of Pentecost, that we need to have that spirit to keep us together. We could use a lot more. The Holy Spirit came at Pentecost. This was a time when the people were all gathered together for Pentecost, which was 50 days after Passover. And for us, it is and becomes 50 days after Easter. We hear about the tongues of fire, and I've heard of churches that have tried to reenact that by having lots of candles around the church on Pentecost to represent all the tongues of fire. It would have given any fire marshal cause for great concern. Now, it was a church down in Florida that thought, we'll recreate the winds that were talked about in the lesson that we had this morning. And so the minister brought one of those airboats that goes across the Everglades into the church, harnessed it to 2 pillars, and had done the practice and arranged that when that time came in the reading of the lesson, it would start up and there would be wind blowing through the church. Well, Sunday morning is different than Saturday night practice, so the lector had read the lesson from Acts chapter 2. There was a mighty rush of wind, and the engine started up, and the air flew, and so did all the church bulletins and people's wigs and toupees and all the rafters. Pentecost was a time that brought the followers of Jesus from sadness to joy, and survival to renewal, and despair to hope. And so what does Pentecost mean for us? First of all, it means that Jesus is forever present. You see, for those early followers, they had heard the stories of Easter and Good Friday, just like we have. And they have shared the stories like we have of the road to Emmaus and how people had recognized that Jesus was with them in a way that was very special and unique. And there is the story of Ascension, and Ascension was last week. We don't mark it very often in the United Church, as in it's quite a deal in some denominations, but it is that Jesus returned to heaven. And so the people had these stories about Jesus having returned to heaven, and so wondered, what are we to do now? Pentecost gave to them an experience that Jesus was alive, that Jesus was in the midst of all the mysterious things that they experienced, and that Jesus offers through the Holy Spirit great power. The consequence of Pentecost is that Jesus is alive again, is powerful, is present where two or three are gathered together. Jesus is no longer and has been. The church could not have survived long without Pentecost, would not have survived with just the historical memory of Jesus. But in them, and they felt bonded and felt that they were a part of the community. This is the Spirit empowering the church. The Pentecost also means for us that we remember the power of language. What does the lesson mean? And in some of our native churches, there is that recognition that for all their struggles, that the land means so much to them, that the land has been given to God. And so for us, all languages are about understanding, that we try to work together to be in the church and to understand each other and to be drawn together in Pentecost in that. And so we have Pentecost, the time of the Spirit of the church. It has so many meanings for us. And one is simply that we are empowered and drawn together because of Pentecost. Some time ago, I had a youth confirmation class, and we spent some time writing up a cheer for
thank you.
try to involve their community around them. And it's been kind of moving for the church for him to look at ways in which we do that, giving gracious invitation to people in the community around us, as we're also at being able to relate with those in other cultures, and also talks a lot about church systems, so that's where I've become familiar with him. And so he has this writing, we used it for a few weeks, I guess, so that it's something different for us and speaks to us of our dedication. Let us join together in our prayer, and we will be singing the Lord's Prayer at the end. Oh God, we come to you today with our prayers of thanksgiving. We are glad for all of those who are first responders, firefighters, and ambulance people, and so forth, that help out in times of need. We think about the significant role that they have had in the fires in Alberta. We just add a thank you for the way in which people give of themselves to help others through first response. And oh God, we thank you today for farmers who are out on the land, planting the seeds, farmers feeding the world. Dear God, we give thanks to you for this way in which people offer themselves to serve. And, oh God, we thank you for those who work within our medical institutions, for all of the nurses and the aides and the doctors and all of the many different professions that work within medical institutions. We are thankful for all that they do for us to try to keep us well. And we thank you for teachers of so many kinds within our education. We thank you for the work that they do and the dedication that they have, that they truly do make our world a better place. And oh God, we just take a few moments in silence now to be with you and to offer up our thanksgiving for all that we have received in our lives and all that is so special and unique to us. God, we thank you for the Spirit of God who draws us together in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray as